So when do you turn when departing on an IFR flight? We'll discuss three scenarios that determine when you do need to make that first turn after departure. There's three possible scenarios when you're departing IFR in broad terms. And we're going to start simple to complex. The first scenario is we're taking off from an airport served by an instrument approach, but there's no published departure procedure. Take a look at our videos for the standard climb gradients to check out what you need to meet in terms of a climb gradient when you're departing with no departure procedure. In this scenario, taking off from an airport with no published departure procedure, no SID, no ODP, and you're gonna fly the runway heading to 400 feet above the airport, 400 AGL, and then you'll turn on course, and that could be a heading assigned by ATC or your cleared route. So you're gonna follow your clearance at 400 feet, essentially. An example where you might follow this type of departure procedure is in Brookhaven. There's no published departure procedures, and you'll make your turn at 400 feet, in this case at an uncontrolled airport, on course. The one exception to what we just said about turning at 400 feet is if you take off out of an airport which does not have any instrument approach to that airport. An example of that would be Beltsville 14N. From experience, you want to depart in visual conditions from one of these airports, even on an IFR flight plan. So the second possibility for an IFR departure and determining when you're going to turn is an obstacle departure procedure, or an ODP. We'll look at Poughkeepsie in this case. Depending on the obstacle departure procedure, you may turn at 400 feet or you may turn at a higher altitude. So you're going to fly the procedure as is described. The turn altitude is specified in the ODP. And on runway 15 in Poughkeepsie, we're going to make a left turn, direct the Kingston VOR to 1400 feet before proceeding on course. So in this case, we're going to take off, fly runway heading, and then at 400 feet above the airport, turn left, direct the Kingston VOR. If you look at runway 6 in Kingston, that's a different ODP. In that case, we're going to fly heading 063, or roughly runway heading, to 2,000 feet before proceeding on course. So in that case, we're going to turn at 2,000. Almost all ODPs will have a greater than standard climb gradient associated with them. If you have questions about climb gradients, check out our video on climb gradients. The third scenario of when you are going to turn after departure is if you're assigned a standard instrument departure procedure, or SID. In the case of a SID, similar to the ODP, you're going to turn when the SID tells you to turn. SIDs are going to be assigned to you on your clearance, and if you're cleared on that SID, you have to comply with it. Some SIDs are very simple. They'll just give you a heading to fly after departure, for example. If it doesn't specify an altitude with that heading, going back to our first scenario, you're going to turn at 400 feet above the airport again. If that turn is associated with an altitude, then you'll turn at the altitude. Some SIDs are quite complex with lateral tracks to follow, multiple altitude restrictions, and possible even speed restrictions. Let's look at a SID in Teterboro, the Teterboro 3 departure, and we'll use runway 19 in this example. In this case, they specify an altitude where you're going to turn of 900 feet. So you'll climb runway heading to 900 feet and then make a right turn to 280 degrees. And after that, maintain 2,000 feet and don't climb above 2,000 feet. Looking at that same chart, but runway 16, we're going to turn to a heading of 040, but there's no altitude specified. So in that case, we'll make our turn at 400 above the airport, and then we'll follow the SID. Check out the link for the blog on the video description below.